Are you ready to go? Well, thank you for your time. My apologies that we're a little bit late, but we needed to set up properly. I understand this is being live streamed back to Brisbane. Firstly, we would like to start off by again acknowledging the late Detective Senior Constable Damien Leedy, and confirm, of course, the arrangements that have been advised that his funeral service will, for police honours, will take place next Tuesday at 11 a.m. at the Convention Centre here on the Gold Coast. And as has been indicated, it's an open funeral service, so members of the public wishing to pay their respects and attend that service are welcome to do so. We would advise, though, that people monitor the information we'll provide in relation to that. And clearly, we expect there will be a very large number of people there, so our advice also would be to be there well before time. I might ask Paul Wilson just to give any update in relation to the service, and then we'll come back to the media release that we're putting out now in relation to a new unit here on the Gold Coast and in the region.
Thank you, Commissioner. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. As the Commissioner said, the police funeral with full honours will take place at 11 a.m. next Tuesday morning, the 7th of June, at the Gold Coast Convention Centre on the Gold Coast Highway at Broadbeach. As the Commissioner said, we do urge the members of the public and everyone else to come as early as possible prior to that. It will start at 11 a.m. There will be a media release by my superintendent, Superintendent Paul Seabarth, who is the officer in charge of the funeral, and all preparations are well underway for a police service with full honours. Normal policing events, as you all understand, that do take place in our community at the same time while we grieve and pay respects to our fallen colleague will still take place. So the policing response in the Gold Coast, Coomera and Logan areas will still be maintained by our other officers. Today we're continuing to provide the fellowship and the service and support to Damien's family and loved ones. All his family has now arrived, and we're assisting them and providing our normal traditional support that we do. Thank you, Commissioner.
Yeah, thanks very much, Paul, and can I thank the media on behalf of the department as well for your support through this time and your conveying of the circumstances of Damien's courage, his heroism, to the broader Queensland community and the Australian public. None of us wanted this to happen, of course, and we all wish we could go back to last Sunday night and avoid what happened and bring him back, but we know that's not possible. All we can do is do the best we can. Through the media's advising the community about what has happened, it seems to have touched a nerve, and the response has been really quite overwhelming, really, I think. And that is, I know, a great comfort and support to Sonia and Damien's family, and certainly his colleagues, so we thank you for that. Today we are announcing an increase in numbers here in the southeast region and the formation of a quite unique and specialist unit. Initially we're referring to it as Taskforce Resolve. It will consist of 18 detectives headed by a detective inspector, and second in charge will be a detective senior sergeant, and there will be four teams of four detectives, each headed by a detective sergeant. So it will be a group of very experienced officers. And their role, they will be based here in this building for the southeast region, the regional headquarters, and their role will be to support detectives throughout the region in all three districts. That's the Gold Coast district where we are now, Coomera district, which is a new district which we established at the end of 2009, and Logan district, and in the investigation of serious violent crime. We want this group to start next week, and to do that we have had to obviously do some creative human resource management activity. So the way we've achieved that is to get the State Crime Operations Command in Brisbane to provide 12 detectives, and we are taking three State Crime Operations Command detectives who are already down here doing other work on another operation. A long-term one that's been focusing on drugs and property crime, together with three detectives from the region. That'll give us the 18. Over time, and as soon as we can do it, though, we will transfer in 18 new positions. So these positions, this is not cut and paste, there will be, as soon as we're able to do it, 18 additional detectives here in the southeast region to form this unit. As I mentioned, it is unique. We haven't never done this anywhere else in Queensland. It's going to be a mobile group of skilled detectives, experienced officers, who will, as I said, focus on serious violent crime in the southeast region. They won't take over completely the role of the existing detectives throughout the region, but they will come in and assist and support in terms of the high-end matters. The work they will start with will relate to those very, very serious unsolved armed robberies, and obviously armed robberies will be a key part of the work they do. I think there are about seven or so, what we call high-end of the more serious type of armed robberies that are still unsolved. Having said that, can I say to you that the detectives here on the Gold Coast, in my view, do a magnificent job. The clear-up rate for armed robbery, in my view, is quite high, approaching 50%. And sometimes, of course, we know that if we catch someone for one armed robbery and we only have evidence for one, it may well be that they're responsible for others. But so I think that they're doing a fine job. None of this is in any way a reflection on their performance, which is outstanding. What it reflects is our concern over the level of crime on the Gold Coast. And look, traditionally, and you can go back 15, probably 20 years, this region, the southeast region, has more crime than any of the other seven regions in Queensland. That doesn't mean that it's, I believe, a bad place to live. Of the eight regions in Queensland, there has to be one region that has more crime than the others. This region also has a very high population. It has a high tourist population, and as we all know, it's a very popular place for people to come and visit. Paul Wilson and I monitor the needs here. Paul has been the Assistant Commissioner here for some 3 years, and we regularly monitor the needs here. We have done a number of things in terms of responding to the need. Every year we've increased police numbers. In the 10 years that I've been Commissioner, we've increased police numbers in this region by nearly 500. At the moment, it's around 450. This announcement today is an additional 18 positions as well. We've committed to establishing a beat, a police beat down at Burleigh, and we've allocated six additional positions for that. And we are, in an ongoing sense, looking continually at the needs of the region, adjusting to those and doing all we can to provide the best possible policing service we can for the southeast region. This is another step forward in that direction. It will be a permanent unit, as I said, that will focus on serious violent crime, I think it will be a great support to the detectives and all of the police in the region. That's probably sufficient from me now. Happy to take any questions you have about this or any other matter.
Commissioner,
rightly or wrongly, fairly or unfairly, it seems almost inevitable there's going to be a perception that this initiative you have announced today is a consequence of Damien Lee's death. How do you respond to that?
Of course, Damien's tragic death had some part in the consideration of this, but it is completely true to say that this is part of an ongoing body of work. Last year, Paul arranged for an evaluation of the needs of detectives here in the region, and that evaluation is fairly consistent with what we've actually done. In the last rollout of additional staff, we allocated 14 extra detectives for the region. This group of 18 puts into place essentially what that report recommended in the first year or so of additional detectives for the region. As well, as I mentioned, we recognised the growth at Coomera and we established a new police district there at the end of 2009. So this is part of an ongoing, consideration and examination of things. But it is true to say that we are extremely concerned about the increase in armed robberies, the spike that's occurred in recent months. If you go back over 15 years, it's quite remarkable. Could I just talk about that for a moment? That the trend in Queensland has come down for armed robberies. Can I just give you some very brief figures on that? Back in 1999, there were 1,314 armed robberies in Queensland. 1,314. And the rate was 37 armed robberies for every 100,000 people in Queensland. In last year, in 2010, that had gone down from 1,314 to 789. And the rate had gone down from 37 armed robberies per 100,000 down to 17, which is better than half reduction. But that's not occurring here in this region. It's occurring across the state, but it's not occurring here in this region. What's occurring here in this region is that it's quite erratic. The numbers of armed robberies in this region fluctuate between about 200 and 300 each year. Some years it's around 200. It's actually been as low as 180. But this year and last year and I think the year before, it's around 300. So what's happening in this region is not consistent with what's happening in the rest of the state. So that's something we need to be mindful of. Over a year, there'll be some months that'll be higher than others, obviously. It'll be up and down. But the spike and the increase in recent times is something that's a great concern to us. Could I just comment on another issue? The other thing we're very concerned about, of course, is the use of firearms in armed robberies. And to us, that doesn't matter whether it's a real firearm or a replica firearm. For the traumatised victim who's had a gun pointed at them, they don't know whether it's a replica or a real firearm, and they suffer possibly the lifelong effects of the stress associated with that matter. Neither do the police. If the police are quickly on a scene and someone's got a handgun, they don't know whether it's a real or a replica firearm. And I'm prepared, if you wish, anyone who wants statistics, please ask us for them, and if we're able to provide them, we will. And I do have statistics on the percentage of weapons used in armed robberies throughout the state. And back in 15 years ago, in 1997, 40% of the armed robberies in the southeast region involved a firearm. In recent years, that's come down to about 20%. And fairly consistently, and it's running at 19% at the moment. So approximately one-fifth of the armed robberies here in the southeast region involve the use of a firearm. But there is clearly a concern about the increasing use of firearms. And I talk to Paul regularly, several times a week, about crime here in this area. And we both have a concern about the public perception about firearms involved in crime and what we think is, in fact, an alarming and concerning trend towards firearm-related crime. So all of these things have had a bearing on it. But to answer your question and come back to it initially again, yes, sadly, Damien's death was a factor in this consideration, but it wasn't the only factor.
Commissioner, can you just clarify the 18 extra detectives? Are they going to be over and above the 14 that you've already... Yes, it's already been announced.
Yes, that was a separate group. They were out of the previous years. Look, what I do is this. Every year, the government gives me a number of additional police. And we have 16 areas in the service that compete for those officers. The southeast region is one of those 16 areas. It's my job, in consultation with others, to carve those numbers up and allocate them as fairly and equitably and sensibly, depending on demand, as I can across the state through all of those areas. Those 14 extra detectives were out of the last allocation. What we're talking about now is next year's allocation, and we've indicated that we'll provide 18 additional detectives. We've also committed to 6 extra police for the Burley Beat, so that's 24. We're examining ways that we can provide other officers too. Of the 31 districts in Queensland, Coomera District, in my view, is the district of greatest need, and we're mindful of that. That's why we created it as a district. The growth there is phenomenal, 50,000 additional people in the next 5 years. So of the 31 districts, we see Coomera as the most important of the 31 in terms of need. And we've done all we can, we'll continue to do to meet that need. But we think that this unit will provide, is the best way forward in that space, because serious violent crime can occur anywhere. We've had 3 armed robberies overnight. One was in this region at Daisy Hill, one was at Townsville, one was at East Brisbane. So serious violent crime obviously can occur anywhere. So we think to have a mobile regional resource that can go and help local detectives, whether that's at the bottom end of the coast at Coolangatta or up at Logan or at Coomera, is the best way forward.
No consideration for a CERT unit down here at all?
No. We have a CERT unit in Cairns. I think we're one of the few police departments in the Western world who has 2 emergency units, one in Brisbane, and the main one, and one in Cairns. And I think we're one of the few police departments in the Western world, in Paul Wilson's previous region, that has 2 police academies. We have one at Townsville. So we see North Queensland, as an area of need because of the great distance. But CERT are based on the south side of Brisbane, and they can be here very quickly if they're needed. And they were, in fact, used in the investigations that followed the tragic shooting of Damien last Sunday night.
Is there any concern you're going to leave yourself short somewhere else until the full-time positions are filled?
That's part of our job in terms of being senior managers, to find that balance. And might I say that, we have 22 people in our senior executive, and everyone has a very corporate view of the world. And I think all of our, senior executive recognise that this region at the moment has the greatest need of any of the eight regions.
You say that this region has the greatest need. Is there something that you can attribute that to? Is there a reason why the South region has a greater need?
It's always been so. I'm happy to discuss statistics over and over. The realities are, though, that if you look at the rate of violence, in other words, what we call offences against the person, sadly, the worst areas of the state are not here. Sadly, the worst areas of the state are isolated communities in far north Queensland and far western Queensland, places like Mount Isa in that broad area. There are long-term established reasons as to why that is so. And I'm happy to provide you the statistical data that backs up that claim of mine. And if anyone would like it, please contact our police media people afterwards, any request you have. But for as long as I can remember this area, but it relates to population, it's, in my view, something that there has to be one area. Obviously it has more crime than other areas, but this is, in my view, a very, very good place to live. Most of our police here don't want to leave. Whilst they have a high workload, very few of them are saying to us, and if they did, we would listen to them. Very few, if any, are saying to us, look, we want to move to somewhere like Bundaberg or Maryborough or somewhere where it's a bit quieter.
Commissioner, are you confident this task force that you've announced today can stop the rot that's been occurring down here?
Look, I wish I could give you a guarantee that there'll be no more serious violent crime and serious violent armed robberies of the type that occurred particularly on Sunday night. I can't do that. All I can say to you is that we will do our very best to both investigate and solve serious violent crime, and of course, you're quite right, prevention is a key factor as well. None of us want these offences to occur, and I've heard, and we are very focused as well on trying to prevent them occurring, and I wish I could say to you we'll eliminate all serious violent crime. I can't do that. I don't think any police commissioner anywhere could do that. I also wish that I could say to you that we will eliminate and prevent serious violence against police, but I can't do that either. Again, all we can do is try to minimise the risk in that regard, because as I've mentioned previously, you cannot do a job which essentially is to provide for the safety and security of the public without putting your own safety and security at risk. And one of the finest examples of courage and heroism that you would have seen in that regard was the work of Damien leading last Sunday night, because he knew what he was going into. It wasn't as though he went to a job where he had no idea what was happening, that he was just going to make an inquiry and someone shot him through the door as he approached the door, as has happened in the past. He knew that it was an armed robbery in progress, and I believe he knew that there was the probability that hostages were taken. And knowing that, he went in and confronted that situation.
Commissioner, you've had discussions with the Premier. Is there anything more the government can be offering you in the way of resources?
Look, every year, I compete with the other government departments, the Health Department, the Education Department, the Transport Department, who want to build roads, for a piece of the Queensland Government budget. Now, having received that, and every year in the 10 years that I've been privileged to do this job, the government have given us extra numbers of police. It's my job then, with my colleagues, to use that money and those extra resources and distribute them fairly and equitably and as best we can across the state. We could always use more, we could always well use more. But we also recognise that we put up our hands to do these jobs, and doing these jobs means that you manage within what you're given, because you have to.
Do you think the formation of this squad, though, will send some sort of message to the crooks out there that you guys are serious about stopping what's been happening?
We always have been, I'm hopeful that the establishment of this unit will reinforce that message.
Commissioner, would it be fair to say that part of Damien Leading's legacy, this task force was on?
It is true, absolutely true, that Damien's tragic death, in terms of our consideration of issues, contributed towards this decision, but it is equally true to say that the increases in needs of this area have been well and truly under consideration for some time, and a lot has happened on a regular basis in that regard, and I want that to continue to happen into the future. Now, if people, and we are certainly willing to take that on board, as well as part of our organisational culture, and it's not, now's not the time, but we will formally pay tribute to Damien in some way into the future. Now, that might be that we name a building after him, it might be we name a police vessel after him, but certainly he will never be forgotten, and in a formal sense there will be some official recognition as well at an appropriate time in the future.
Do you think this squad, though, would have been established without what happened last week?
I think that is highly likely, yeah, because we had been looking at the best ways that we could put into place, you know, to provide the best policing response here. And this is, we've never done this before. We've had what's called tactical crime squads, which we've established throughout the state, which are uniformed officers who go and do street public order type work. But we've not done, this is fairly different and innovative. But because of just the sheer volume of activity in this region, the spread of it, in a social sense, it's very different. I mean, you have Logan with its characteristics to here, with this what people call the glitter strip across the Harbour surface, down to Coolangatta, out to Bay Desert. It's quite a large and comprehensive region. So we felt the best way to provide support for the high-end serious violent activity is to have this mobile unit of experienced detectives. And obviously we will monitor the effectiveness of it over time.
And will all 18 be based here at Surface Paradise?
Yes, right here in this building. Yes, okay. They will, yeah. And as I've said, we've had to do some innovative, you know, cut and pasting to establish this group to get it up and running next week. But in the fullness of time, there will be 18 additional positions, and we're going to try and achieve that within 12 months.
Just on that 18 additional people, so you've got 18 that you're bringing here to form this squad. Are you going to replace those with the new 18, or will they stay there and then it'll be 36?
Yeah, it could be either or. We're bringing 12 down from State Crime Ops. We're finding three from a group here that have been working on drug and property crime, a group of 12, three from State Crime Ops, and let me go back over this if it doesn't, you know, make sense. And we're finding three from the region who've been working in that project team. It's called Project Alliance. So we're taking six from there, 12 from Brisbane from State Crime. That gives us the 18, and we'll establish that next week. Then we'll start to go through the human resource management process of creating the positions, advertising them, letting people apply for them on merit, compete for them. Now, it could well be that some of the people from Brisbane, you know, that come to work here, want to apply for those jobs and stay here. And if they do and they compete on merit, as we all have to do for a job, then that's fine.
So it could end up being 36 in this squad?
No. The 18 that we're establishing next week are temporary people, and in the fullness of time we'll replace them with 18 permanent positions. Okay.
So with the 18 that are being put in the next week, obviously there's a sense of urgency with this one. Can we at least attribute your action now to the events of the last few days?
I think, and I'm happy to go over it again, but I hope that I have tried to cover that. I do not resolve from the fact that the tragic death of Damien Leedy was a consideration in the urgency of what we've done. Together with the spike in our robberies in recent times, and we are hopeful that spike will go down and that will even out, but we can't sit around hoping. Together with the work we have done in recent times, the review here of the detective strengths needs, the recognition of the need for extra detectives, I believe this would have happened, but certainly this tragedy has brought it forward perhaps earlier than it might have. And look, I hope you see that as being responsive to emerging situations. Can I say, though, in addition to that, that the tragedy of violence towards police is not confined to here. When I think back over my own career and where police officers have been shot and killed on duty, I can think of only one place where it's happened more than once, and that's Rockhampton. And now Rockhampton is not a high crime area. They have their problems, but it's not a high crime area. And when I think back over the course of my career of the colleagues I have known have been shot and killed, that's happened all over the state.
Commissioner, do you think that something needs to be done in terms of, or more needs to be done in terms of stopping the drug problem, because that seems to be contributing to most of the crimes that we see.
I think you're exactly right, and one of the things we've seen emerge as a trend in recent times is the use of amphetamines. There is no good illegal drug. There is no good illegal drug. And for some time now, people who've committed armed robberies, in many cases, have had a drug addiction. And one of our great concerns is when they commit those armed robberies, that they are irrational and their behaviour, you know, is dysfunctional because of that drug addiction and that craving for money to buy drugs. However, I think that amphetamines take it to another level, because amphetamines appear to be a drug that make people elevated, angry and aggressive. And so that's added another dimension in terms of the risk our people face when they deal with people who are using amphetamines. And we have had examples of incredibly, frighteningly strong, aggressive, violent behaviour from people who are using excessive amounts of amphetamines. And I've had police officers relate to me the almost superhuman physical strength of these people, and officers with 15 and 20 years service telling me that in their entire service they had never encountered anything like it. Just, you know, almost unbelievable physical strength and almost impervious. And that's one of the reasons why we brought in tasers, because a taser will disable someone. No matter how strong they are, it will actually disable them, because it affects the central nervous system. So the physical strength is irrelevant if the taser is used appropriately.
Commissioner, out at Coomera Police Station, the floral tribute, Damien Leading, a lot of members of the public are going up there, writing in the condolence register and things like that. And just some of the comments there that people repeatedly make, like they say, you know, enough's enough, and it's almost, you get the sense that they want to reclaim their community. I mean, are you getting that sense?
Yes, we are. Yes, we are. And we are deeply, as everyone is, moved by what is happening here. And as I mentioned at the outset, I think the media's bringing what has happened here to the notice of the public seems to have touched a nerve. And we've always been of the view, and we've been police officers for a long time, we've always been of the view that we do have the support of the majority of the community. And I don't mean a vocal minority group, but the quiet, silent bulk of the community. We do think we've had their support. But what this tragedy seems to have done is somehow or other ignite that support. And we are grateful for that, I'm sure, and I know that Damien's family are grateful for that, and his colleagues are grateful for that as well. And that support is not something we take cheaply. We are very, very appreciative of the significance of that. And we just are grateful and acknowledge everyone in terms of, identifying and bringing it forward in the way it has.
There's been some renewed calls for a police helicopter of all things. Do you think we need one here in this state?
Look, happy to debate that, obviously any resource like a helicopter would be a nice thing to have. I'm on record as saying that our aerial needs, firstly, are for the really isolated areas. And at the moment, we need two. We have six aircraft, and we actually have one of the biggest aerial fleets of any police department in Australia. We have a jet. We have a large aircraft called a Beechcraft B-19 that goes back and forward from Brisbane to Cairns 3 days a week. And we have a plane called a Britten Norman Islander in the Torres Strait, and we have several Cessna caravans. What we need, a couple more of those Cessna caravans in the bush, for our officers in places like Charleville and Longreach in those isolated areas. Once we achieve that, then I'd like to move into the space of helicopters, but you have to do it in sequence and in priority demand, and happy to discuss that separately at any time.
You mentioned the drug trade has been a big part of this. Will you still be looking at that as part of what they do?
Well, where that's relevant, clearly, but the primary work will be serious violent crime. And within that space, their priority will be the higher-end armed robberies. And despite the outstanding work of the local detectives here, there's a number that involve licensed premises that still remain unsolved, and they'll start. When they start work, that'll be the starting point, and together, sadly, with any others that occur as well. But as you know, armed robberies involve a whole range of activity, and in some cases, and they're all serious, they're all absolutely serious, but extraordinarily, on the very first night after this, on Monday night at Coomera, at around 7:30, at a bottle shop, two offenders went in there with a hammer and committed an armed robbery. I think, you know, I mean, that gives you an example of the scale and scope of, not that that's not serious, but I don't think anyone would argue it's as serious as the offence that occurred on Sunday night at Pacific Pines. Okay, no other questions? Okay, thank you for your time today. I greatly appreciate it.
Thank you.